Today we're gonna make this rigged arm follow a Bezier curve. Stay tuned to the end so I can show you what else you can do by using the same principle learned in this video. Sometimes we spend hours and days polishing our arcs, only to hear that our client or director wants something else. I'm gonna use this main character to do a different animation in this shot, and for that I need a rigged arm, so why not use the one we already have? This arm is rigged with Rigify, and as you can see, I'm using the FK bones. Place the 3D cursor on the start of the bone. Then go out of edit mode and create a plane. This plane is gonna be our curve guide. Snap the right edge of the plane to the 3D cursor. Use keep offset, because otherwise you'll collapse the points as well. And then move the other side in place. Now to be precise, do the same thing again. After this becomes a bit repetitive, but hey, we'll do this for the middle one as well. Introduce a new loop cut and snap it to the cursor as well. Then reduce the size so it's easier to look at. And then go into the modifiers tag. In here, we're gonna add a curve modifier and set the curve object to be your curve you want to use. And you see now the plane follows the curve. The more segments it has, the more fluid the curve is gonna be, of course. But our segments are gonna be determined by the amount of bones we have. I'm gonna create new vertex groups, 3 to be precise. I'm gonna call them root, elbow, and wrist. For these groups, I'm gonna assign each corresponding edge on the plane, going from right to left. And that will look something like this. I can visualize it in the weight paint mode. With this setup, we can now go into the rigging part. Select your first bone and go to the constraints tab. Here, choose copy location. Select your curve guide as the target, and in vertex group, say root. On top of that, add another constraint, choosing the copy rotation. Do the same thing, so the target is the curve guide and the vertex group is the root. That's fine, we just have to add a stretch to constraint. And the vertex group is the elbow this time. So that is the next vertex group in the line. Now it points in the right direction, only it's too big. It is stretched out. What you have to do is go to original length and click on this cross right here. And that will reset the length. When I start rotating and translating it, that the arm is moving along. If I select this vertice, you can see that the right side of that bone is moving along as well. Okay. From here, it's basically rinse and repeat. So what I'm gonna do is select the next bone in line, select the other bone we just did, search for copy constraints to selected bones. Now everything is set up already, but we need to fix the vertex groups. First, I'm going to delete every vertex group, just to be sure. Insert elbow, elbow, and for the next one, you should use wrist. And then, of course, don't forget to reset your length. Same thing here again, select the wrist bone, then the forearm bone, search for copy constraints to selected bones. And with those selected, delete all the vertex groups and say wrist, vertex group wrist. And now we don't have any vertex group to look at, so we have to create this. That's fine, we can just do it right now. Again, I'd like to align it to the bone, so let's do that right now, like we've seen before. Go into the plane edit mode, extrude on the x-axis. Maybe it is better when it's all lined up, so I'm gonna snap it to the top instead of the wrist pointing down a bit. With that in place, we can now add a new vertex group, go to the object data tab, make a new vertex group called as hand or whatever you want, and then assign the outer edge to this vertex group. You might need to remove this from the wrist as well. Perfect. Now go back to the wrist bone. Of course, it's not rotating the right direction. We need to stretch it and select the target. That's gonna be our curve guide. And vertex group is gonna be our hand we just created. Reset the length, and there you go. The orientation is a bit weird. We can rotate the plane, or we can go into the copy rotation for the wrist constraints, go to mix setting right here, that's set to replace, and change that from replace to add. And with this set to add, you can now add your rotation on top of the copy rotation constraint, if that makes sense. Then if I enable the curve modifier for the plane, you can see that the arm now follows the curve. It isn't perfect, the hand is kind of flipping upside down, but that's also because we are moving over one axis. I think if we go up or down, that it will sort it out. And we can, of course, additionally keyframe our rotation. So if you are ready, you can now adjust your curve to the desired motion path you want. I can move it along the x-axis and it swiftly moves along the curve. For me, it's time now to adjust some weight painting because this comes from another mesh. I don't have the shoulder bone to influence the upper arm, so I need to fix that and say that it's part of the upper arm, right? This might or may not be necessary for you, but it's always good to check your weight painting. So for this example, I need to scale it up. It's a bit unrealistic, I know, but that's the aesthetic of the scene. Usually for this I use origin set to the cursor, and to move it around in the scene I usually parent the plane to the curve. If you want to adjust the curve, you have to unparent the plane from the curve again. I like this to be a spiral around the doorbell and then just hit it and go back. So after some extruding, rotating, translating, you can see that I came up with this spiral. And when I move it over the x-axis, you can see that I come from behind, move around the doorbell, and I can press it. Now the next thing is not a necessary step, but I like to add a single bone so I can drive the plane by using this bone. In the bone settings, I choose a widget. I already have a lot of widgets from my rig, of course, so I choose this widget for the jaw. Now I've got this nice sphere, and then the only thing left for me to do is parent the curve guide to this bone and use automatic weights. Right now everything is set to red. That's fine if that is what you want. What I like to try is get rid of the end part, so the shorter part of the arm stays a bit more behind. If you don't want that, paint everything red. If you want more, try experimenting with the weight painting. To illustrate what I mean, I move it into place, and when everything on this edge is set to zero, the shoulder stays behind. In this case, that gives me some weird deformation issues that I don't like, so what I do is I smooth out the weight painting for this particular curve guide. From here on out, I can use this bone to animate my arm, and I'm gonna start animating right now. And I'm gonna set a keyframe roughly here. Then move forward in the timeline and move my bone over the x-axis, so the arm moves forward. Keyframe again, and that is our basic animation. Now say you want to animate the fingers as well. I usually select everything and then go into the set rotation mode. You can access that by hitting Ctrl R or go into the menus. For this particular animation, I'm fine by using XYZ Euler instead of quaternion. Then with all these bones selected, I'm gonna set my pivot point to individual origins. If you now rotate the fingers on the x-axis locally, they will move individually and create a fist. Okay, so I'm gonna set my first finger pose touching the doorbell. Keyframe the rotation, and then moving a few frames back, set another keyframe in a rest pose. Then I'm gonna do the same thing for the other fingers. I like to keep them a bit closer. That looks a bit more aesthetically pleasing if you ask me. But whenever it is a resting pose for the fingers, I usually keep them together. Therefore, it creates more contrast when you splay the fingers out. So I don't think I want the fingers both to close onto the doorbell. I think one should already be closed. So I can delete all of these keyframes for the lower finger. And this is our basic animation. What I'd like to do now is create a anticipation keyframe for the finger so it moves slightly back before it touches it. In my experience, that creates more of a snappy animation. From here on out, it is just playing with the timing. So that basically means moving keyframes around and adjusting the rotation of the fingers to get better looking poses. Of course, the next part is the interaction with the doorbell itself. So I'm gonna set a keyframe for the location. But before I do that, I like to apply the location of the doorbell. Move a few frames forward, whatever you like, set another keyframe, and then I'm just gonna mirror those doorbell poses to the other side. So we have a in and out motion with a little bit of a rest in between. Now, of course, our stopping point of the finger on the doorbell is not entirely correct anymore. We need to place it a bit more forward. I can just create a new keyframe here and move that up on the y-axis in the graph editor, until it sticks onto the doorbell. A little bit of fine tuning by adjusting the position again. Here I make sure that the animation actually holds because I changed the keyframe, of course. And it also means that I have to hold the finger pose as well. Then I copy the starting position and duplicate it over to roughly here to reset our arm back into the scene. And then when we play the animation, it looks something like this. Of course, there's a lot of tweaking we can do. The finger goes to the doorbell. We can figure that out later. First, get the basics done. I like to adjust the root controller spacing a bit. I want it to start slowly, speed up, and then slow down again, but in a more condensed way. And then, of course, when it moves back, I like to do the same thing, have it snap back more by scaling this keyframe and adjusting the curve. Now you can see there's a little bit of offset. The doorbell already comes out before the finger pulls back. To easily fix this, I'm gonna use the doorbell's keyframes, because there are only two, and place them a bit forward on the timeline. And this is the beauty of working like this. I'm not entirely sure about the position. I want it to be a bit more in the center so I can easily adjust the curve. Imagine if you have to do that, all the work you did, all the polishing you did, and do it all over again if you change the position or whatever for your fingers, for example. Now I'm quite happy with this animation, after some tweaking of course. And I think there's only one thing left to do, and that is animate the material emission of this doorbell. That's easy to do. I have a mix RGB node set to blue and green, and then I just use the vector to switch between them. You can keyframe the vector by hovering over it and pressing I. Go into your dope sheet editor, and when you go in there, make sure that you have your node selected. So I have to go back now into my node editor, select the node, and then go back to the dope sheet editor, and now it shows up into my dope sheet as well. I'll duplicate this keyframe and set it right there. And then in between there, I'm using the graph editor. Then in the curve editor, create a new keyframe by hitting I. Move this keyframe up to 1 because we want the value of the vector to be 1. Hold this keyframe for the amount of time that our finger is touching the door. And that is our animation done. Now to get some cleaner result, I like to add a corrective smooth modifier. Place this above the subdivision modifier. And then you can play around with the vector, repeat, and the scale settings. Check this video if you want to learn more about that. From here on out, it is adjusting the weights, adjusting the mesh to get as clean of a result as you can get. Well, additionally, you will discover that you can apply the same principle of making armature bones follow a curve using path constraints, but achieve different, equally impressive results by using various modifiers. I used the plane guide here, not to follow a curve, but to shrink wrap it onto a landscape. If you want to learn more about this particular instance, let me know in the comments down below. And with that said, I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you learned something. If you did, leave a like. And if you want to learn more like this, check out this video. As always, stay creative. I'll see you next time. Ciao.